the biggest deal in tech history. Michael Dell launched a $67 million bid to buy EMC, which we probably know for being a big data storage business, among other things. If you look at the details of this, it's $49.5 billion of debt, which is going to require. He's got regulators to keep happy, you've got shareholders on the other side to keep happy. Michael, why?
So look, you know, we've been on this journey that started about 32 years ago in my dorm room with $1,000. And in the last 7-8 years, we've really been focused on building end-to-end solutions for our customers. And you know, trying to solve the challenges and opportunities that the customers have. And you know, 2 years ago, we went private. We've been investing much more heavily in innovation and R&D. Filed 27% more patents last year than the year before, highest number in our history. We gained share in our client business 11 quarters in a row, continue to grow our server business. And the combination of Dell and EMC together, along with it, control of VMware, creates a really incredible company. A company that is absolutely a leader in today's IT, in servers, in storage, in virtualization, and PCs. And it creates a company that is a leader in tomorrow's IT, digital transformation, the software-defined data center, converged infrastructure, hybrid cloud, mobile and security. It creates a company with unprecedented reach and access to customers, from the very largest companies in the world to the emerging small businesses and medium-sized companies all over the world. Also a company with incredible scale, the number one enterprise systems company in the world with more than $80 billion in revenue, and a company that is privately controlled, that's not focused on a 90-day shot clock as public companies often are. So I'm very, very excited about what we can do for our customers in this new combination.
Nobody can say you're not being involved in this. But how much do you worry that there could be risks attached to something as ambitious?
Well, you know, I'm not afraid of risk. I mean, I think risk goes along with innovation. And you know, one of the problems, I would say, that larger companies have from the perspective of an entrepreneur is that they think of risk as something to avoid, right? And we want to have risk mitigation, we want to have risk reduction, we want to have you know, all these sort of things. I understand that. But if you want to innovate and you want to do new things, you have to embrace risk. And you know, so I understand there are four risks. But if you also think about the strategic context of what we're able to do for customers, think about what's happening with converged infrastructure, which is real. You know, think about what's happening as you go from the siloed platform, second platform, to the application and data layer. Think about what's happening in the explosion in devices, the capabilities that we have in this combined company, which are quite interestingly highly complementary, so not a lot of overlap in the businesses. The reaction that we've had from customers and partners has been overwhelmingly positive. So I'm quite excited, happy to take on the risk, and perfectly happy to take on a path that's different from others. You know,
about innovation, isn't it harder for a bigger monolith of a company to move quickly and innovate compared to some of the smaller, more nimble companies?
I think you have to make sure that you're injecting innovation and risk-taking into businesses as they grow. I think there are many different models for that. So inside Dell, we have a number of fast-growing units that we've either created, started up, purchased, and incubated. And it turns out EMC has also had a similar model for this. So if you think about how does a company innovate, how does it grow, you have organic investment, you have partnerships and alliances, you have minority investments in other firms, you have acquisitions. I think there's a model where you incubate new businesses and, in many cases, leave them alone and let them benefit from some of the strength that the mothership might provide, but not just combining together some big amalgamation which destroys their culture or their uniqueness or the special things that they're trying to do with and for their customers. So, we're working on new ways of creating new capabilities, which are different from just having a big amalgamation of things.
And the opportunities you see, you talked about the digitization of all sorts of industries, all sorts of sectors. What specifically do you see as the big new open doors? You talk about the Internet of Things, or where is the future?
I think it's one of the most exciting times maybe to be alive and in our industry. What we see our customers dealing with, whether they're in product industries or service industries, is that they're figuring out how do they make their products and services more digital. How do they insert digital technology? In some ways, they have a kind of digital fear because they see all these new businesses that are being invented or created, and certainly work with those companies too. But the question is, with the cost of acquiring digital information going down so rapidly, and the ability to move products from analog to digital, how do you turn all that digital information in real time into better insights, better outcomes, better results? And you think about the explosion of devices, whether it's the Internet of Things, the machine-to-machine communication, the artificial intelligence, the drones, the robots, all that great stuff. You have like 1,000 times more devices. And then within those devices, you have like 1,000 times more applications because they're doing far more intricate things than they were doing before. And then the richness of the data, it's 1,000 times 1,000 times 1,000, very large numbers. And then how do you take all that and change the experience so that it's essentially better for the customer? And so all of our customers are trying to figure out how to do that, and they want to fund that by making their existing infrastructure more efficient. And so we're here to help them do both of those things.
Your customers, though, are increasingly using mobile devices. That seems to be a trend that still hasn't peaked. Yet most people here will see Dell as a PC legacy business. And from the numbers I've seen, the PC side of the business is still significant, and I think because I've seen, say, about 30% in my company will be about PC. Isn't this a bit of a burden, this legacy business?
I think a few years ago there was this idea that the PC is going away, right? And PC is going to be replaced by a smartphone. I think the reality is we have multiple devices, right? And so about 1.8 billion PCs in the world, and about 600 million of them are more than 4 years old. And so our simple job is to create a PC that's better than the one that we sold you 5 years ago. And it's actually not that hard to do, right? And so as we do that, we create these great beautiful products. Eventually, there's enough things that are compelling about the new ones that cause you to say, yeah, I think I'll replace my 5, 6, 7 year old machine. So it's a business that's not really going away. Certainly, it's changing as well. You've got virtual PCs, you've got gaming PCs, you've got high-performance workstations. And importantly, the foundation of that business is what is driving the Internet of Things. So our large industrial customers are all embedding intelligence. And we've got hundreds of IoT projects going now, which are essentially like little pieces, right? That are inside all sorts of equipment, making it intelligent, often feeding into our data center equipment to provide real-time insights. So, it's a business that's going to be with us for a very long time because how do you consume all the information? There are going to be lots of different devices, and we see those devices continuing to be important.
So you still see the desktop PC as a significant part of Dell's future?
It's not just desktop, right? It's mobile, it's workstation, it's virtual, it's gaming. Certainly in terms of, we don't see that as going away. We've had 11 quarters in a row of gaining share. If I look at our investments, we're certainly indexing a lot of our investments into software, into security, into the whole software-defined data center, hyper-converged transformation in those areas.
You couldn't have done the deal you're proposing if you were on the public markets. You took Dell private a couple of years ago, $25 billion deal. How has life improved since you become a private company?
It's been great for me. It's our freedom of operation and being able to invest in our business has allowed us to change our time horizon thinking out to 3, 5, 10 years. And so, we do extensive customer survey with our customers. This last survey, we had the highest ever results in the company's history. We do an internal engagement survey for our team members. Almost got it. That had the highest scores ever in the survey we just completed. So our customers, our team members inside the company seem to like it. And it's given us a lot of flexibility.
What's the hardest part of the journey of building up to what it is now?
The hardest part? I can't really say that there's been something that's incredibly hard. I think certainly one of the things that has become far more important from starting to now is how do you grow and develop talent? And a company that has the best talent ultimately wins. And so that's something I've spent a lot more time on in recent decades, right? versus starting out. And how do we cultivate and grow our own talent in a very powerful way? Certainly, the process of going private, that was relatively challenging. We we got through that, and I think it's provided a real platform for us to rethink our business.
Let me ask you a bit about where the markets are at the moment. There's a lot of talk about not just unicorns, but decacorns. Do you think tech companies are worryingly overvalued?
You know, there'll be better speakers to ask than me on that. I mean, what I see in this whole move of IT out of the realm of just automating the old processes and into fundamentally changing and reinventing businesses is that the available pool of IT and how it's affecting the overall economy is just exploding again. Opportunity. And so I think there are a lot of really incredible new businesses being created. And which one will be successful and what will be worth the markets will figure that out.
Can't help thinking like $67 billion is starting to look like quite a lot of money. Michael, why are you calling the top of the market?
No.
There was a very famous deal between AOL and Time Warner that back in the day was the biggest so far then. That didn't work out too great in terms of shareholder value. And there are some studies, I think KPMG did a study back in 1999 that said most mergers failed to add shareholder value. I think they said 83% of them don't add shareholder value. So how can you be sure that this deal is going to boost overall value?
Well, reality is you can't be sure, right? and that's how markets are made, to take on risk. What I see is that converged infrastructure and the software-defined data center are absolutely real. We know that one of the interesting things about the combination of EMC is that for almost a decade, Dell EMC had a rather significant alliance. We worked together very closely, customers loved it, and you know, then we stopped working together. And there's a tremendous amount of great things that come together as we combine the server and the storage. And again, highly complementary capabilities in terms of the two firms, in terms of where technology is going. And time will tell. But as I said, great reaction, overwhelmingly positive reaction from customers and partners.
So what kind of company do you think Dell would be, let's say, 5 years from today?
We intend to be a company that helps our customers in tomorrow's IT. So if you think about this enormous digital transformation that we're really just at the beginning of, you know, think about all of the enormous amount of information that's being created. Very, very little of that is actually being used to make decisions, particularly in real time, to do anything of a great value today. That's an opportunity that's enormous for the IT sector and much, much larger, like trillions, for the overall economy. So we want to help lead the way there. We've got lots of enabling platforms. One thing I mentioned just in passing at the beginning is security. And this is very important because the cyber threats are not getting any easier. And we know from our SecureWorks business, from our SonVol business, EMC's RSA business, our work around threat intelligence, the Cybercrime Inc., whether they're state-sponsored or criminal organizations or terrorist groups or hackers, activists, the level of activity and complexity of the problem, and particularly when you expand the number of nodes with all these sensors, each node becoming a point of vulnerability, all of the SCADA systems in the industrial context, that's a huge problem or opportunity to secure all of this digital transformation. And we're very much, we're in a great position to help our customers address that challenge as well.
There's no startups here that would love to have a masterclass with you, mentorship from you. We only have 2 minutes, Michael. So, in your 2 minute masterclass for the Web Summit, give some of the startups there some advice that you learned in your journey building up to.
I would say don't be afraid to fail. Be pretty fearless. Right? If you're fearless, you can accomplish just about anything. I would say if you find a problem, you want to fix it as fast as you find it. I would say that your potential is probably far greater than you've experienced. And if you throw yourself into challenging situations, if you can find a way to throw yourself into challenging situations, you can probably accomplish way more than you ever imagined or dreamed.
Last question. You talk about being fearless. Is there anything that Michael Dell is afraid of?
Yeah, I'm afraid of failure, so I'm not completely fearless. But if you're too afraid, you won't do anything, right? So sure, I think about what can go wrong. I think about what we learned from the past. I think about what others have learned. But look, I started this adventure in my dorm room with $1,000. So far, it's going pretty well. My little startup has had revenues of more than $900 billion since we started. So we're going to have $1 trillion fairly soon here. We're having a little party. You're all invited. And so.